Hello, good morning. Yes, so I'm Dr. Hélène Lavoie. I'm specialized in international relations and within that in strategic foresight and warning for national and international security. And I'm also the director of a still new and young think tank, the Red Team Analysis Society, which aims at promoting strategic foresight and warning for national and international security. Okay, so first of all, I'll go to anticipation, and sometimes I dream of a world where we would have no different labels, but only anticipation. But actually, this would be not that nice because each has a very specific meaning, as you point out. So foresight, and more exactly strategic foresight, is more a qualitative methodology, where this is what I do, where you can use plenty of different other methods such as forecasting. So forecasting is much more quantitative and fundamentally statistics. Prediction is something that nobody does anymore, because prediction implies that we know exactly what the future will be. So prediction is more what you would use for a crystal ball, and unfortunately none of us has one. A prophecy is something which is linked to the divine, and it comes from a prophet, and so it's the prophet hears what God tells him or her, and will just reveal the divine words to the world. And I don't think that any person doing foresight and warning has this kind of relationship to a superior power. Also, what is kind of interesting is that I wonder, because historically, the domain or the field of prophecy was belonging to the priest. So I wonder sometimes if some people unconsciously do not expect people doing futurism or strategic foresight and warning or anticipation to have this kind of link to the divine, but I don't think we have it, except for maybe some very lucky ones. And you have other, according to countries, sometimes you have other labels, such as I'm thinking about horizon scanning, that is used mainly in the UK and also in Singapore. But horizon scanning is also qualitative and covers any methodology that is useful to a tier, to a state, to foresee the future or risks. Yes, of course, we have to consider the way of the past, because we have to identify actually the process and underlying processes and dynamics that will lead to some type of events, or I don't really like very much the term of trends, but of trends. And of course, trends are process. First, they have their roots in the past. And secondly, our only way to unveil them or uncover them is to look at the way it worked in the past. So we have to understand the past with science, most of the time. And then out of that, we identify factors or variables and how they link between each other. And then this gives us process. We have to also allow for the happenstance of new variables or new factors. And out of this understanding of the past, then we can foresee the future or the futures and define a border of plausibility. Actually, you have many methods. But I think that if you look at most of them, they are all grounded in the same methodology, which is, if you go very quickly, which starts by asking and defining your question and your scope and the time frame. Because if you study a question, and if you look at how it will work out within 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, or 50 years, it's not exactly the same. And I guess that as military, you are very aware of that, because you need time to develop material, for example. So you have to define your question. Then you make a first literature review, state of the art, which allows you to understand your question. The second part is to make explicit your model. So this is what we were talking about before. And this is always the same. You identify variables or factors and actors, or you have factors and actors and you transform them in variables, which is not always obvious, especially to students. You link them, for most methodology, you link them. So when A, you have A influencing B, for example, some methodologies such as GBN do not link factors. You make what we call an influence analysis to select the most important factors that will influence your question. And out of that, you can develop scenarios as well as warning, because each of your variables actually are indicators. And once you have all that, you have to deliver it to your clients. And fundamentally, if you look at most methods or most or all methodology, or I'm even thinking with all thinking, all the analysis is always based on this fundamental method. Personally, I think this is really a very interesting and fruitful and good way. I wouldn't say this is the best. But because for when you do foresight, you have to define the cone of plausibility, what all the possible or potential futures that could happen, and scenarios are perfect way actually to identify large trends or large possibilities for all those futures. So of course, you will never, most of the time, you will never get one scenario exactly right, because the way the life will express itself will be a bit different. But each scenario will represent an ideal type of the way your future can occur. And thus, to me, this is really a wonderful tool. There is a pretty strong methodology to create it. You can also explain how it comes about, and then you can give likelihoods to your scenarios. You should also ideally say when they should happen. You can create sub-scenarios, which would be the next step after a time T, for example, and you can accompany each scenario of indicators. And as you monitor what is happening in the world, then you can know if one scenario or another is becoming more or less likely. And with your monitoring, you can then update your whole scenario and even your model. So I think this is really an extremely powerful tool. And finally, if you really want to develop narratives, for example, you have the global trends, the American global trends, 2030, 2035, and so on, that do that at the end of their product. If you want to develop narratives are an excellent way to overcome some of the biases that your policy or your decision makers may have. I'm talking about cognitive biases. So I can't enter into the details, but really narratives are very important to make someone understand what can happen in the world and in the future. And alternatively, we could devise maybe films, you know, or movies, but we are not there yet, and it might not look serious either. I think this is really an important question, especially when actors are involved. Of course, ideology distorts not only our analysis, but also all the understanding of each actor. So you can go back to international relations. Jervis just wrote a fantastic book on that and created the idea of image. But I think that to consider ideology or the perception of others and how they are built, this you should input it into your model. Actually, you can define it, you can understand it very easily. But I also believe that you are referring to biases or cognitive biases, for example. And this, of course, it impacts all human beings. It's inbuilt in our makeup, in our cognitive makeup. And the best we can do is being aware of them and try to mitigate them or try to use them. So this is what I was referring to with building the narrative. But when you do your analysis, you have the only thing you can do is to be aware of them and sometimes I wonder if the whole methodology, especially the fact to go through all this process, which is sometimes not very pleasant for people who don't find it fun. I personally find it fun, but to identify all the variables and the factors and so on. And once you have that, you can be much less prey to some of the ideology or belief-based biases or other cognitive bias, but some of them will always remain. And this is the fatality of being human, I guess. So if you have, it depends who predicted it. Actually, if you look at indications and warning, or just with the warning literature and all the literature on intelligence failure and warning failure, you will see that you have very, if you look at the, you will see that in the process, you have very different places where the whole process can fail. So when you say someone has predicted it, but it was not heard, actually, it may mean different things. So if it's someone just alone in his or her room, you know, in front of a computer predicting it, but who doesn't deliver it to anyone, so actually it was not really a warning. And you can't really bring in all the ideas of everyone because first they may not give it to you, or you may not find the right person, and how can you evaluate the idea of one person against another, especially except if you have, of course, a model. And so yes, you know, most of the time things may have existed, but if they are not included within the process of searching for sight and warning, you enhance the odds that you will just miss something. But most of the time things could have been delivered and were not paid heed attention to. Yeah, I think that actually we need foresight not to be reactive but to be proactive. But this is interesting that you say that, because I think that increasingly most people are doing foresight and linking it to crisis management, so actually to be properly reactive. But ideally we should do foresight to be proactive and to do things, you know, 5, 6, or 8 years before the events happen. But yes, definitely there is a need for a network, but also with a danger. So a network would be great to exchange ideas and to identify areas in terms of methodology where we need to put more effort and to allow experts from different point of view or different areas to work together, also to exchange ideas. In practice, because there is a lot of competition among experts when they are in the private or academics when they are in the academic world because of funding, you know, you may not have such a nice and wonderful cooperation as we may dream of. The other warning is that having plenty of experts and giving them, for example, a topic as what keeps you awake at night, you know, will give you some ideas, but it doesn't replace hard work, which is just like to follow proper methodology, to wonder what is your scope, what is your question, what is the state of the art literature, and then to create your model and to do the whole process. So it may give you ideas, it may be wonderful if you have developed a proper strong methodology and a proper design to include all these experts or specialists within your exercise, but I think you should always remain a master of a strong methodology. Oh yes, definitely. But when I was thinking expert, I think I didn't, I had not in mind, you know, an expert who had only closed sources. Also, sometimes it's I was reading this morning an article from the New York Times where the U.S. intelligence now has, I don't know how many terabytes of data on the Islamic State and studying the Islamic State. I would really love to have access to them, which I shall not have. But most of so many experts actually have only access to open source intelligence or open source information. And you know, but a lot of information is always open source, so it is. I think that we assume that 80%, or we calculate 80% of the information is open source. So already having 80% of information available, it's a lot of information to analyze. So yes, open source intelligence and information is crucial, and you can get plenty of very interesting things. I would say that in terms of methodology, no. As long as as you have a sound methodology, which is fundamentally the scientific methodology. You know, it's adding scenarios. Maybe that in science scenarios are not always done. But as long as you have a sound methodology, you can address any problem. But then what you have to include is when you create your model or when you look at the literature and do the state of the art, there you have to use specialists or people who are a bit trained, you know, in political science, in security, in military affairs, military studies, strategic studies, and so on, because it's besides the methodology, then the content of what we need to bring inside the foresight exercise is not exactly the same. And also, I was thinking in terms of time, it may be more important in terms of national security and international security and military affairs to not to be wrong on time and on timing to allow for a proper response than it may be when you are developing, I don't know, an Apple Watch or whatever. Maybe for Apple is very important too, but in general terms, the consequences are not the same. So if your country fails or if an alliance fails, the price to pay will be in terms of lives. If a company fails, it's bad, but it's only money. So you are asking me to do what I say we should not do, so to look at my crystal ball, isn't it? No. I don't suppose. So I would say that if we take the largest and deepest, you know, the most encompassing threat, I would say it's definitely climate change. Climate change, and in it I include biodiversity changes, because there we are really in trouble, I think, and we are not doing much. Then I would go towards at the system of the international society level, and I think that we are seeing a shift, certainly from unipolarity after the end of the Cold War to multipolarity. And in the context of this shift, I think that the way the potentially ex superpower reacts, considering its power, is crucial and can imply a lot of instability. And also, each time a system changes, you see a lot of instability. And with all that, I would say that we are most probably living a crucial period of paradigm shift, which will imply that we redesign all our systems. And when I say systems, I also say socio-political system, ideologies, and so on. And I think, or it's probable, that it will be of the magnitude of a switch from the Middle Age to the Renaissance, and probably the birth of and the development of the Islamic State is part of this shift. And so the Islamic State would be one of the main threats, you know, that I would add to those I have already mentioned. And then you have plenty of other smaller ones.